you know, I mean, inform them about our concerns on EIA. Maybe they get an opportunity to change their perspective and represent our views in the parliament. So this is also something that we are planning. And I'm not taking much time. Let me invite my colleague, my friend, Dr. Srinivasan, to give the introductory note and welcome the speaker and the participants. Srini, please.
Vishnu, good morning to everyone. I'm Srinivasan, faculty member, Tamil Nadu Dr. Ambedkar Law University, Chennai, and I welcome everyone to today's session on competencies-based legal education. Competency literally means it is an ability to do something successfully and efficiently. Competencies-based education is the alternative way for the learners to gain knowledge, skills, and attitudes, and to be successful in working environment. It moves education from focusing on what academics believes graduates need to know to what students need to know. It is a performance-based learning process which is diverged from imparting of theoretical knowledge in the classroom. With this brief note, I would like to welcome our resource person of this seminar, Professor Dr. Shantakumar. It's my honor and privilege to welcome Professor Sanjeevi Shantakumar, Director, Gujarat National Law University, on behalf of Legal Academia. Professor Dr. Sanjeevi Shantakumar is the alumnus of Madras University and started his career as a senior lecturer in the Government Law College, Madurai. He becomes Professor of Law at Gediyathullah National Law University and founder director of ITM Law School, Maths Law School, and Pro Vice Chancellor and Dean School of Law, GD Goenka University. He has published a number of research articles on contemporary legal issues in various national and international journals and edited volumes. He authored three books on environmental law published by LexisNexis, Tamil Nadu Dr. Ambedkar Law University, and National Law School of India University, Bangalore, and two books on human rights law. His book on human rights law, published by People's Watch, is being used as a handbook for training the human rights defenders by many civil society organizations in India, and it is translated into many Indian languages. He has presented papers and delivered keynote addresses in many national and international conferences in India and abroad. He has been involved in the training of the law teachers on legal teaching and legal research at various universities in India as a part of the British Council funded project. He had visited premier universities across the globe, including Oxford, to understand the best practices in legal education. And I hope that this lecture would aim to open avenues for faculties to exchange ideas and learn new tools and techniques for competencies-based legal education in the post-COVID era. Now I pass on the mic to Professor Dr. Shantakumar. Sir, now I pass on the mic to Professor Shantakumar.
Thank you, Vishnu. Thank you, Hari Shankar. Thank you, Srinivasan, for inviting me and giving me this opportunity to share my experiences and views on this topic, competencies-based legal education. So I want to start with a disclaimer that I'm no expert in this topic. I'm a beginner, just started to understand what is this all about. I'll just tell it in the form of a story. Before we get into the competency based legal education, I want to generally take you through certain things what happened in the 1980s. So in the 1980s, a lot of our engineering graduates from India, they started moving to United States of America for taking up assignments related to software and many things. So this was there was a huge exodus of people, engineering graduates, to United States of America. So please, you know, I'm just transgressing a little, but then I'm giving you the the background of how this topic came into existence. So when all these engineering graduates started moving from India, mostly from the southern parts of India, from Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, they were all going to United States of America. They started occupying and a number of positions in the software industry in the United States. There were certain associations in the United States, out of which one is very important, known as the International Engineering Alliance. They felt that how do these guys, so many people are coming to United States and taking up jobs which would have been otherwise available to a US citizen, right? And therefore, and then with a lot of people traveling to United States, you know, especially in the field of engineering, then the International Engineering Alliance, they came out with certain standards by telling that we need to standardize engineering education, because there's a lot of people coming from not only from India but from different countries at that particular point of time. So the Engineering Alliance felt that now we need to standardize the engineering learning processes, and to ensure that the engineering degree obtained in India is comparable to that of an engineering degree in United States of America. So the first issue was comparability. So how do you compare that an engineer, a BTech graduate from India, is comparable to that of an engineering graduate in United States of America? So the first keyword that what we need to understand and what we will be using throughout is comparability. Because of globalization, because of the free movement of natural persons from one jurisdiction to another jurisdiction for taking up assignments. So this issue came, like, how do we know that so many engineers are coming from India? How do we know that these engineering degrees are good enough, or whether these students have a solid background, basic knowledge of their core domain area, and how is that we can rely on these engineers? So the issue of comparability, and then the second thing was compatibility. This knowledge of engineering, what they have obtained in India, how it will be compatible to the US systems, right? So comparability and compatibility was the main concerns for standardizing the engineering degree across the globe. So this made the Engineering Alliance to come out with an agreement, an international agreement called Washington Accord. I do not know how many of you have heard about. This is generally, you can Google, it's generally known as Washington Accord. So this Washington Accord is an agreement wherein countries can sign up, and once you become a member of the Washington Accord, then, and again, you know, becoming a member means that you are complying with the standards that are set for an engineering institution. So only those countries which meets out the standards prescribed in the Washington Accord for an engineering graduate, only from those countries, the recruiters in United States of America can recruit. So initially, a few countries, then if you are not a member of this Washington Accord, your engineering student will not be recruited in United States of America. As a result of which, India was forced, or rather, compelled by these circumstances, to comply with the US standards of engineering education. We will not call it as US standards now, because now most of the almost 20 countries have now signed this Washington Accord. So now we can even call it as a global standards of engineering education. So these countries, they in 1989 they signed this Washington Accord. India became a member, I think, in 1994, when Indian government created an institution called the National Board of Accreditation, NBA. And this NBA was declared as the agency to represent India to ensure standards of engineering degree in India. And NBA is the signatory to the Washington Accord, and therefore India is represented in Washington Accord by the National Board of Accreditation, which was originally in 1994 a part of AICT. Now it is no more. It is now, after I think 2013, it is almost an independent and autonomous body, the National Board of Accreditation. So this is which is very important. You know, we need to know like what is happening in the other disciplines, how the degrees, the standards are getting standardized, right? So this was this is one important development. What happened in other field, I just wanted to bring it as a cross reference. And this 1989 Washington Accord was again at a later point of time it was improved, and then there are two more accords which was signed later, which is known as the Sydney Accord, and there is another accord called the Dublin Accord. So these are the three international agreements. International means, you know, it's not an intergovernmental agreement, but it's just an international alliance of engineering institutions. So these are the three accords: Washington Accord, Sydney Accord, and Dublin Accord. Please, after this session, please take time to go through this. These are generally available on Google. You can read and understand what these accords intend to do. So the idea behind all these agreements is to provide create a comparable standards of engineering education, so that engineers from these countries can move freely to another country. So an engineer who has an engineering degree from an institution in India, which is accredited by NBA, will not have any problem traveling anywhere in the world, because his degree is accredited under the Washington Accord, and therefore those institutions will only check that whether your degree is accredited by NBA and it is a part of the Washington Accord. So this, so that, you know, recruiters throughout the world, they are aware of a minimum set of standards, that okay, the engineers coming from NBA accredited institution in India will have at least this minimum amount of domain knowledge and minimum amount of skill sets, the graduate attributes, whatever is prescribed under these accords, the Washington Accord, the Sydney Accord, and the Dublin Accord. Now, this happened in the discipline of engineering. It's just a story for us to understand what is happening, so that we can ask ourselves whether this kind of standard setting is happening in legal education, right? So that is where you know, we need to have a comparative understanding. So in engineering, there are standard setting bodies. There are accrediting agencies which check programs. See, again, I want to make one very important point. All of you need to know that there are two accrediting institutions in India. One is called the NAAC. All of you are familiar with the NAAC, the National Assessment and Accreditation Council, based at Bangalore. This NAAC accredits institutions. They will go inspect an institution. They will go to a university. They have certain standards, and they go and they have a checklist, and then they go and see whether these universities match the standards prescribed by NAAC. And if you match the standards, then they award you marks for each and everything, and then they grade the university like A plus, A, B plus, B, and all these things. So that is an accrediting institution, university, like say Madras University. So Madras University is accredited with a particular letter grade, and NAC does that. Now what NBA does is, NBA doesn't accredit institution, it only accredits programs like BTech program. There are, you know, I know institutions which runs say 4 engineering program like BTech mechanical engineering, BTech civil engineering, BTech electronics and communication engineering, BTech in computer science. Out of these 4, all the institutions, they will try and give these engineering degrees for accreditation by NBA. But NBA will accredit, if it founds okay, then maybe it will accredit one program. Say, for example, civil engineering. So civil engineering degree of that institute is of global standard, not the rest of the other programs. So this happens in many universities, but among educated parents, they will not have this knowledge to go and see for programs which are accredited. They generally have this herd mentality, and everybody would want to go to BTech, IT, BAT, but without knowing whether this program is accredited by NBA, because only when that program is accredited, then the movement of the students becomes very easy. You will see that, you know, those people who are employed, for example, even in institutions like TCS or Wipro or Infosys, only some people will get the opportunity to go to US, and others are not. That's because these are the guys who have graduated from an institution where their degree was accredited by NBA. So this is some kind of standard setting which is happening in another discipline, the engineering discipline, which we need to keep in mind. So now I think I have made clear about NAC accreditation and NBA accreditation. NAC accreditation is for the institution, and NBA accreditation is for the programs. So NBA accredits BTech programs, BArch programs, BPharm programs, and MBA programs. So these are the programs which are currently being accredited by NBA. So NBA has the standards for these programs: architecture, engineering, pharmaceutical sciences, and management studies. So these are the programs which NBA accredits. And in the case of NAC grades institution, so you get mark for each of, for fulfilling those conditions prescribed by NAC, and then you get a B grade, B plus, C, C plus, and other thing. But in the case of an NBA, either you are accredited or not, which means either you are pass or fail. There is no grading. So if you match the requirements of NBA, then you are an MBA, you have an NBA accredited program. If you don't match, then which means your program doesn't comply with the standards, so you will have to again improve on all these things, and then you will have to resubmit yourself for reassessment. So this is how this accreditation happens. Now we need to come to legal education. Now just ask for yourself whether we have any such accrediting agency for legal education programs. Because when it comes to lawyers, we do not face the kind of exodus which happened with engineering graduates moving to different countries. So maybe that might be reason why there was no effort taken at the global level, at least to my knowledge. There was no such effort at the global level. But those countries where there were a lot of movement amongst countries, is one particular region is Europe. Within Europe, within the European Union, all these countries, a graduate of France, a law graduate from France will move to Belgium and he will work. A law graduate from Belgium will move to Netherlands and he will work there. A graduate in Netherlands will move to UK and he was working there. Some will go to Spain, some will go to the other European countries. And there was a free movement of people. And therefore, in Europe, there was a need for coming out with a certain set of standards, even for legal education. Because lawyers were moving from one country to another country freely, and they were taking up work in different different countries within Europe. And therefore, European Union felt that we need to have something like Washington Accord for engineers, something like that we need to have for law graduates. So the European Commission had come out with certain strategies, which please Google for something called Bologna tools. Bologna is the city in Italy and Italy, and because this agreement was entered there, it is known as the Bologna tools, which talks about these three things: comparability, compatibility, and transparency in assessment. Right, so we will go into it when I am going to actually get into the subject. So first, I think now I have completed almost 20 minutes. I have just given the background for all of you about the need for a global standards for legal education, which is currently not there. And I have just given example of engineering degrees, where there are degrees, where there are global standards, and there are accrediting agencies which enforces these standards, and which also sees, monitors whether these institutions maintain those standards expected out of this what expected by Washington Accord, something like that. Right. Now, as far as law is concerned, we have seen that there is no such global effort, but in Europe, within Europe, they felt this need because members, lawyers from one country within Europe were traveling from another country within European Union, and therefore they felt that there must be some uniform standard, and therefore they had come with certain standards, which they call it as the Bologna tools to assess the standards. And now, what happened? European Commission was supporting universities to do some research on this particular field under a project which is an Erasmus Plus project called as Tuning Project. So the idea of a Tuning Project is to fine tune the academic programs to match with the graduate attributes. So this is the main thing, you know, in competency based education. The main focus is to see that whether your education, the education that you offer in your institution, gives your students the required, the expected competencies that are required for succeeding in the legal profession. So this is a project called Tuning Project, and in fact, the European Commission was implementing this Tuning Project, funding universities to tune their academic program, to see whether their programs are compatible, and whether the assessments are transparent. So these are the three keywords which we need to remember. And this is what is the background. Now I'll come to me and how I got into this project. So when I was a pro vice chancellor at GD Goenka University, In fact, it's not me, it's the university's project. University, the GD Goenka University was one of the 15 Indian universities picked up by an European partner at Bilbao, Spain, called the University of Deusto, which was executing the Tuning Project of Erasmus Plus. I hope I'm making things clear. So European Commission, there is a university in Spain, in Bilbao, called the University of Deusto. They have a project, they got a project which was supported by the European Commission under the Erasmus Plus scheme to do a tuning project. And now, after these things have happened, you know, happening for the last 20 years, and now the European countries have started taking this project to other continents, like they did this Tuning Africa project, where they went, because most of the graduates from African universities, they migrate to Europe for seeking employment. So their first focus was to ensure that the European, the African universities meet those standards or this expected thing, so that they can, Europe will now require a lot of people from other countries to come to Europe to work the thing. So they wanted to ensure that the other universities in the other countries, wherever people come from for employment, they want to ensure that those countries, the universities, meet these comparable standards. So likewise, they had this Tuning India project. So University of Deusto had this Tuning India project, where Deusto was doing a Tuning India project on competency-based education in four disciplines. One is medicine. Second was ICT, Information and Communication Technology. Third was in the field of education, teachers. And fourth was law. So in fact, this was the first time in India they are doing this Tuning India project for law programs. So we had 15, they had identified 15 universities. That's a big story. Again, that's not relevant for us. How did they identify? So they had identified different universities, public universities, private universities, a lot of other forms of institutions. So 15 universities they have identified. And fortunately, since I was at that time working with GD Goenka University, I became a part of this project. And we had, out of these 15 universities, which was picked up, we had almost 7 universities in India which had law schools. So we had 7 law teachers representing this project, working in this project. So we had periodical meetings, which was financially supported by University of Deusto, because as principal investigator of the project, they were funding this project. In fact, whenever they come to organize these meetings, they come with their team of European universities, the delegation from Europe, and also they bring experts from various fields to help us in identifying the competencies on all these four disciplines. So the first such meeting happened in Bangalore. Again, I do not know why Bangalore was picked up, but then Bangalore was the first location where the University of Manipal, I think University of Manipal was one of the universities in this Erasmus, the Tuning India project. Therefore, Manipal decided to have it in Bangalore because of better connectivity, so that all universities can come and go easily instead of traveling to Manipal. Therefore, this Manipal University organized this event at Bangalore. And there we were explained about this competencies-based project, the importance of identifying competencies. So that was an eye-opener for all the law teachers who were there, because we never had this kind of an orientation in legal education. Fortunately, because I had worked with few universities which had engineering school in it, and since I was in the leadership role, I had a lot of interaction with the leaders from the engineering school, and therefore I was quite familiar with Washington Accord NBA accreditation. In fact, I was also a part of the team which was preparing the university to present these programs for NBA accreditation. Therefore, I was a bit familiar about the expectations. So this is the personal experience as far as this project. Now, getting into the project. So when these 7 law teachers joined together, maybe I was the oldest, I think, by age or by experience. So people, they chose me to be the coordinator of the India group for this Tuning India project. Then I became the coordinator, and I was very fortunate to have a wonderful colleague from JNU, Dr. Puneet. Dr. Puneet is an associate professor in the School of Law and Governance at JNU. We made him the co-chair. I was the chair and he was the co-chair for this India group. And we had representations from the Pune University and other universities. Right? Now, the first task that they gave us was, what they asked us to do is, and it's an interesting way that, the Europeans train people. Like, I have spent almost now 30 minutes just talking about it, right? And Europeans do not talk this much. They just, speak for 5-10 minutes, and then if the same 30 minutes, if you would have given to an European professor, he would have simply spoken to you for 5-10 minutes, and then the remaining 20 minutes, he would have made you do what he wanted you to learn from this. So they, what they did was, they just locked us inside a room, literally, and they said that you guys are not coming out for the next 3 hours. You guys will have to discuss amongst yourself and find out what are the attributes, what competencies a graduate need to possess according to you. You don't need to refer to anything else. What, according to you, should be the competency a graduate must have when he graduates from a school? General characteristics of a general graduate, any graduate. He may be a medicinal graduate, MBBS graduate. He may be a law graduate. He may be an engineering graduate. He may be any from any discipline. A graduate must have a certain competencies. For example, ability to communicate clearly, ability to listen, ability to do research, ability to comply with law, right? So likewise, they said, come out with a set of generic competencies. What do you think a graduate need to possess? What do you think your university is offering a graduate program? At the end of this 3-year, 4-year, 5-year graduate program, what do you think that these students will be able to do? Or what is your expectation that they ought to do? They must do. They must have a certain essential set of skills. So this was the task assigned to us. And then we all sat together and in different groups. There were 4 groups, as I said. Medicine was a separate group. ICT was a separate group. Education was a separate 3rd group. And law was the 4th group. So we all sat in different groups. And then we were discussing about the graduate attributes. And in the second half of the day, then all 4 of us sat together. And then we all agreed that, graduates, irrespective of the discipline, a graduate is a graduate and he must have basic these competencies. He should at least be able to write certain things, right? An application. He should be able to write a CV. He should be able to, communicate effectively. He should have at least the domain knowledge of the subject, the core of the domain knowledge of his subject. So likewise, we came out with a list of subjects, but now I'm thinking that since I have spoken to all of you for now 32 minutes, I think I should take a break. Now, I can see that there are 32 participants, including me. We can just take 5 minutes break or 10 minutes break and sit and think of some graduate attributes. What do you think are the competencies that a graduate need to possess, especially someone graduating from India? A graduate, what competencies he must have? Let's forget for the time being what a law graduate must possess. At least, generally a graduate, what essential competencies that he need to possess. Can I request all of you to take a break of 10 minutes right? Now you can start writing in a piece of paper, or maybe you can open your, if you are using your laptop or desktop, open a Word document, because this is a meeting app. You can share your desktop. That option is there. That is why I had created this meeting in this meeting app, so that everybody will be able to share your screen. Maybe, what we can do, 10 minutes, we can take a break. You can note down, at least 5-6 competencies that what you need to have, what according to you a graduate must possess. And what we can do is, now it is 11:45, I think 11:55, we can come back. At least we can request 4 or 5 volunteers to share their screen and show us what according to them are the graduate attributes. I think we can do a small exercise now, instead of me talking all the time. Why don't you now write down what according to you are the essential competencies required out of a graduate. So can you please do this exercise, and you can type it on a Word document or in a PowerPoint slide, and then there is a share button. Once it is ready, you can start sharing it, so that for the next 15 minutes, I think we can give opportunity for our participants to present their views on graduate attributes. Then I think we will do this exercise until 12 o'clock or 12:15, and thereafter I will I'll talk about the graduate the competencies of law graduates, right? Maybe again we will do some exercise, since we have almost another 1 hour and 15 minutes with us. I think we should go for a workshop model, I think. So now the time is to you. Is it agreeable, Vishnu and Harishankar? Is it fine we do this?
Perfect, sir. Perfect. We can do that. We can take a break of 10 minutes. Yeah.
Yes. Sure. So now, all of you, you need not log out. You can still be on screen. Maybe you can switch off your cameras and switch off your mic. You maybe discuss it, Google for information. You think about what according to you is the competency a graduate must possess. Minimum set of standards. You don't know, a graduate can do many things. For example, a law graduate can even become the Chief Justice of India, right? So we will only talk about a minimum set of competencies. That what do we expect? At least, he should be able to write his own CV, a leave letter, right? Nowadays leave letters have become subject matter of joke going on WhatsApp groups, how they write English and how they write leave letters. So I think this is something which we can do for the next, it's now 11:45. I think until 11:55, we will spend time in writing these competencies. Thank you.
Sure.
Harishankar, can we start?
Yes, sir.
Can we ask for some volunteers who can come out to share their screen and speak few words about what according to them are the competencies that is required for a graduate?
Certainly, certainly. If there are any volunteers, I think it's a difficult task for people to. Maybe I can just share my screen and start off.
Yes, the... you can start, Harishankar. Yes.
Yeah.
So the third button next to camera is share content. You can click that and share your desktop.
Okay. Is this available now?
Yeah. Now we are seeing. Yes.
Yeah.
Five generic skills.
Right. So this is what I've just written. So from the explanation that you gave before the exercise. The first thing is for any graduate, whether he is a law graduate, medical, basic skill needed is to communicate effectively, both written and oral. That includes writing a leave letter or whatever, or maybe even for I've seen even PhD graduates struggling with their explaining their research problems and even their research. So I remember one of my professors telling me about you should be able to, there is something called as an elevator speech. So yes. This is maybe an advanced skill, talking about doctoral graduates and all. But if you have a problem or if you know something and when it is communicated effectively and very briefly, for example, if you have a very interesting cutting edge research problem, but if you can't communicate, let's say in 2 or 3 minutes to a 10-year-old boy or even a PhD graduate, then it is not going to make much of an effect in the society. So that's one thing. So this is an advanced skill, but again, coming down to the basic graduates, everyone should be able to communicate effectively and in any language, need not be in English, but communication is a very important skill. Second is basic or even advanced skills using computers, information technology, internet, and other technological devices. I don't know how to explain all this. This is like explaining maybe in 90s or the early 2000s, talking about literacy, the basic literacy of writing. So now it's not just the basic computer skills. You need to be aware of about what is happening in different fields. And because we are living in the world of an AI, artificial intelligence, so basic technical skills needed. And independence and resourcefulness. You should be not be in a position to depend on other like human beings or even then fourth one is also important because mostly we've seen even after like advanced degrees qualifications, people tend to express and engage in debates without you can have your own ideological beliefs, whatever beliefs or political or religious, whatever, but it is important for me, it is important what I think is it is important for people to have an objective, study both sides if it is a debate. And if you're arguing for something, if you're writing something, it is important to present and at least understand what is the exact position. It need not be the truth, actually, because truth is a very difficult concept. But at least you need to be in a position to accept and to accept the other position, you need to understand what exactly going around you. And that thinking ability is important. That comes out generally when you write or speak. And most importantly, the basic civic sense, your responsibility to the society. I think these are the very fundamental skills that I can think of for any graduates.
Thank you, Hari. Thank you, Hari Shankar. Is there anyone I could see? Using the chat.
I can also share the screen, Professor.
Yes, yes, please.
Is it? Can you see my screen now?
Yes.
Yeah. It's almost the same as what Hari has been discussing. Of course, thinking, listening, and communication in multiple ways: oral and written communication, and then effective use of technology. I would just confine myself to information technology, depending upon the specialization. Specialization of again, I wouldn't call it as attributes of a graduate, attributes of education, maybe at different levels that demands different level of expertise in each of these. So in that context, effective use of technology for computer knowledge or knowledge in the internet is essential to almost all of us. But then effective use of technology, when each of us need to be basically electricians, you know, plumbers. So effective use of technology would be something that is welcome. Then teamwork and maybe the effectiveness of or the capability to play our role in the team and to contribute towards the problem solving. Then, of course, the professional ethics and most importantly, our concern for our fellow human beings, even the nature and the other biotic and abiotic substances. Then I would say at least it is expected that an educated person should have the basic knowledge of their specialization. If he is a graduate, of course, the basic knowledge of their specialization at the graduate level is expected. And then more importantly, the competence of that person to adapt this basic knowledge to the situation, something that maybe we can call it as adaptive expertise. So these are the points that I have in mind. Thank you, Professor.
Hello.
Good. I think maybe one more presenter we can take. Yes.
Can I share my screen, sir?
Yes, madam, please. Who is this?
I am Dr. Harita Devi from
Yes, Baltimore. Yes, ma'am. Please.
Sir,
before that, may I request Vishnu to stop sharing your screen?
Yes, then I am trying to do that, but somehow it is
stuck. I think I already posted in the comments, sir. I think you will be able to see that.
Okay. It is there in the chat box.
One more just to add, because already communication has already been told by Dr. Other thing which I would like to tell is, nowadays, many of the graduates, any discipline, especially IT in law, that they are only trying to read only their subject. Say, for example, if I am a commercial law specialization, I read only company law or contract law or whatever. But I feel that in today's scenario, graduates will have to read other disciplines also and try to make an interdisciplinary analysis, which will help them in a long way. One thing. And the second thing, which is minimum technical skills, that's I think I already Vishnu and others have told that, preferably English. Actually, the other two people who have spoken, Vishnu and Harishankar sir, have told that effective communication. I would like to actually reduce that. It is not about effective communication. Sometimes we see that even the bare minimum communication is absent in even a postgraduate student. So I feel that since I'm from Tamil Nadu, I feel that many students who are coming from a rural background are not even able to communicate what they know. So that would be very much essential for an attribute. Thank you, sir. Other things are, I think, repetitive. It's already there. In the book. Thank you
so much, Harita. Thank you for your contribution.
Professor, if I just have, you know, one page, if you permit me.
Yes, sir. Risham.
So
you have designed a beautiful slide.
Yeah, I mean, it's just I thought, well, maybe so trying to identify three areas for competence based skills.
Yeah, can you just show these slides? Yes,
this is just one. Okay. I mean, just I've put everything in one page.
Okay.
I hope this is clearly visible.
But Risham, you have not gone to the second slide.
I think the second slide has the content.
No, this
yeah.
is this is
yeah,
fine.
Now we can.
Yeah, this is fine. Yeah. So there's some aspects in the LLB and some observations. Certainly, some of the skills have been covered previously by both Hari Shankar and Vishnu. So
I think, Dr. Risham, since you have prepared a skills-based legal education for law graduates, so I think we can take up this slide when we talk about the competencies for law graduates. So we are now currently dealing with only graduates, general graduates, right? I think I will invite you again when we talk
sir.
About the competencies of law students.
Certainly.
But I would want to read out from the chat. I have a contribution by Anil Nair from Nuals. He had written certain competencies which I find very interesting. One is he writes, number one, ability to read. Reading is, again, it is the mother of everything, you know. So reading, ability to read, comprehend, and utilize own judgment and skills to perform a task. It is there in the chat box. All of you can see from there. Take responsibility for the outcome of the task. These are certain values, you know, which every graduate need to possess. Be able to clearly understand whether the task is within his domain or not, and seek help without wasting time. So likewise, and then take initiative without waiting for instructions. So these are all wonderful leadership qualities that he had spoken about, which I found very interesting. And then thanks for others also who have contributed in the chat box. Now, I think, the idea is to talk about the importance of identifying competencies. See, if you look at it, the idea is we need to know what actually the students need to take away from the institution. Then once we know that, these are the skill sets that is essential for a student who is passing out from my class must possess, then as a teacher we need to design our curriculum in such a manner and ensure that which part of my subject or the syllabus or the way that I teach or the activities in which I engage or the assessment that how I am going to involve them. By these things, I should be able to give them all these competencies. This is an introspection for us. Right now, you know, there is no statutory body imposing all these competencies and tells us that you should do this. But as law teachers, you know, we are voluntarily taking up this task and we are now discussing about these competencies. And therefore, we will now, you know, for example, I saw one, you know, I shared it from a Tamil movie. The hero of the movie, he is a gold medalist in his college, he's a top ranker, he got a wonderful placement, everything. But then, you know, when he tries to propose his love to a colleague, then, you know, he gets into all trouble and then he becomes there, you know, he will discuss it with his friends that, you know, I blame this education system. They told me how to do this and that with engineering things, but they never told me, you know, how to say I love you to a friend that whom I would want to propose. So certain basic things, what is essential for life. Like, so whether the schools teach, not to teach, these are things that we need to discuss. But then, you know, when we are preparing and converting an adolescent into an adult, and then we are sending them to the society, we are sending them to the world to lead an independent life, then are we giving them all the competencies that is required for them to sustain themselves as a useful citizen of this society? So that is the idea behind this competencies. Now I think it's at time that we move on to this competencies based on law. So as I told, the exercise that what we did as part of the Erasmus Plus project is, we first first day we spent in identifying the graduate attributes. Then from all the groups we sat together, and then everybody had a list of 20, 30 graduate attributes, because we had a lot of time, so we could prepare a long list. Then, you know, we could see anything matching. Then we prepared a meta profile by linking, you know, merging all the profiles which are matching with each other. And then we came out with a list, which I would want to share it with you right now on the screen. I'll just share the presentation. So this is a presentation which was made by me and by one of the co-chair of this project, Dr. Puneet. So this is all about the idea of competency based education. Sorry, it's not moving. Yes. So this is that you just go through that second point, the competency based education. CBE aims at ensuring that the student acquire the specified competencies during the course or academic program, and they are able to demonstrate the same on completion of each course or program. So that is the simple object. You know, every program, so when we make a course outline, what we call it a syllabus, and then before we circulate, we should create this competencies, expected competencies that what a student will acquire after undergoing this course. So every teacher can prepare a list of competencies that what after undergoing your course, the student will be able to acquire. It may be repeating, for example, this communication, reading, writing, all these skills will be repeating in all the courses, but still in your course, after you assess the students, what are the competencies that your students must have acquired after doing this course? So that is what is all about this one. When things improve, we can have a 1 or 2 days workshop where all of us can sit together, and then we can draft a model course outline with all these things. So that's what, if you can see that, you know, designing an appropriate method of assessment to examine whether students after completion of the course had acquired and could demonstrate. In fact, this is something which I always talk about, in especially in institutions where there are standalone law schools. I know that those law schools in a university which has also an engineering or a management school, they will be the teachers there will be exposed to all these things, drafting a program outcome, drafting a course outcome. And I have known universities where the teachers have gone to the extent of drafting a lecture outcome. So today this is the lecture, and at the end of this lecture the students will know this. The students will be able to do this. So from program, then every course has its own outcome, and even within the course, after every lecture, what competencies the student will acquire, the teachers will be able to track. And I know universities where they are very effectively doing it and tracking it also. In fact, this helps them getting higher grades in NBA, NAC, and all those things. NAC, in fact, gives a good weightage of marks if you do all these things in criteria one, right? So this is one thing. And we're talking about assessment again, you know, assessment is an art. How do you assess your student? It's a science. It's a very well established science, not something new. But unfortunately, you know, that's what I have been speaking at certain other platforms as well, that law teachers in standalone law schools do not get exposed to these kind of the science of assessment. For example, Bloom's taxonomy. So the Bloom's taxonomy gives you how to classify cognitive skills, and how do you assess students? How should your question paper look like? and what kind of questions your question paper should have. We were not trained in it, and at law schools we are not trained in it. Standalone law schools, I am talking about. I know universities which has engineering and management schools along with law schools. I know that the teachers get opportunity to be trained on Bloom's taxonomy and other things, but then generally it's not the case with other law schools. So currently, I think now this is a kind of a new movement, competency-based education. In engineering, you know, they were calling it as OBE, outcome-based education. Now in European Union, they have started using this word CBE, and it is increasingly seen as the model for higher educational institutions. So this is about the project, what we did, and I told all these things in the first half an hour. And I want to acknowledge all these members whom you are seeing on screen, because they have all contributed to whatever I'm going to show you now. So I want to acknowledge their contribution. So these were the people who were there as part of the team to draft this list of competencies. Of course, it's not only our own original work. We also drew from various other continents. Like I said, you know, the Tuning Africa project, the Tuning Australia project, Tuning Asia project. So we had the competencies drafted by these countries. So we had access to those competencies, and then we also picked up a lot of competencies from there, which we found it is whatever we found is relevant for India, we picked. So I need to acknowledge all the other project participants from various other countries, though we did not meet them, but then we had access to the competencies which was drafted by them. So it was a very well thought out effort. So we were asked to define this competency. Generic competencies is for every graduate generally, and now subject specific competencies, that's where. But before we go to the subject specific, I want to quickly just run through a list of generic competencies which was adopted in the Tuning India project. Again, I want to also state that this project is still an ongoing project. It's not over. Still, two more meetings are left to finalize it. Now we have gone a bit in an advanced stage where we have drafted the meta profile, and then we are now coming out with curriculum with all these things. So now these were the ones which was accepted by the complete group of faculty members drawn from four disciplines: medicine, law, ICT, and education. So these were the things which they were telling. Of course, this is not prioritized. And one important thing is, it's not only the view of this 40, 50, 60 people who were present in this preparation. What we did was, the University of Dusto asked us to do a survey of these competencies. So whatever competencies that we prepared, we administered this as a survey to various stakeholders, including employers, peers, the students, and parents. So we administered this, and then we the whatever the results compiled were sent to University of Dusto, where they have presented it, and maybe on some other occasion I can share that report also, which is based on the inputs received from various stakeholders, including employers, peers, parents, and students. Now, these are the list of generic competencies: ability to do research, ability to manage crisis effectively. Crisis management is something very, very important, because, you know, even in spite of being graduate, postgraduate, we find, you know, people reacting very badly under crisis circumstances, right? So adhering to ethical principle, I think Vishnu pointed out to this, ethical principles. Act within the legal framework. You know, this we need to tell people that, you know, whatever you do, see that whether you are within the legal framework, because otherwise generally people feel that they are free to do anything whatever they want to do. In fact, we are coming out with a lot of things. Be socially responsible, be humane, demonstrate environmental consciousness, right? Ability to apply knowledge practically, ability to communicate effectively, ability to plan and manage time efficiently. Time management, you know, how do we teach time management to our students? Are we doing it? Ability to work as a team. How is that, you know, in a law school, we are trying to inculcate this competency, working as a team, because tomorrow these guys will go and join a multinational where there will be few engineers, few management guys in a team, and you know, how do the law students work as a team, how to gel well, now how to be a lifelong learner, how to demonstrate high order thinking skills, acquire problem solving capacity, and be a reflective practitioner, ability to make reasoned decisions, be innovative, have good interpersonal skills. Most of the problems today everywhere in any every workplace is because of very bad interpersonal skills. But how do we spend time in teaching these students these skill sets? How do we maintain interpersonal skills? So ability to work independently in a responsible manner, appreciate and respect diversity and multiculturalism, possess self-confidence and entrepreneurial spirit, be adaptable to emerging trends, practice professionalism, promote and ensure equal opportunities, including gender justice, adherence to quality standards, demonstrate leadership qualities, ability to use available resources optimally and efficiently, ability to manage stress. Again, these are certain things which we do not do in law schools. How do we try and incorporate these things so that our school, our graduates will be able to do all these things? Have organizational and managerial skills. Be motivated for self-learning. Be goal-oriented. So these are some of the, this is an, again, it's not an exhaustive list. This is an illustrative list of what is expected. And again, you know, you can still think about, work on it. Now coming to law, in subject specific competencies for the subject of law, so what we did was we identified a list of competencies and then we classified under three headings: knowledge of what they should have, a law graduate coming out from a law school, what minimum amount of knowledge that he need to possess, knowledge of what. Second is skills. What kind of skills? What essential skills that a law graduate is expected to possess minimum? And third, three is attitude. What attitudinal characteristics, competencies a law graduate need to have? So that is what is present here. I think since there is very little time, I think I will go ahead with whatever, or maybe I think we can take a break here and we can look at, I'll stop sharing my screen. We can request Dr. Risham, because he prepared a slide of competencies for law graduates. Can we have a look at it first, Dr. Risham?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Can you please share your screen?
Yeah. So actually I had prepared this screen, mm-hmm. and I'm most of these have been, you know, covered by everybody.
Okay.
So maybe you know, I really appreciate your involvement in that project. It was very interesting when you mentioned the origin of the competencies program in the starting from the engineering. So suddenly I have tried to classify what can be the key aspects in the LLB, then what can be the key aspects in LLM. I mean, in just in the those 10 minutes, 15 minutes or so, I just thought that maybe we can characterize and classify into three. Mm-hmm. So certainly in undergraduate degree examinations, apart from all, there is another aspect which we use in the MOOCs, online MOOCs, which is through modules. So designing modules, and through those modules, we, you know, sort of give the students to learn at their own pace. And mm-hmm. some students may not be able to comfortably complete in a particular time period. So we have a semester system, but when we create modules, where we have like the MOOCs, so they have their own pace. They can finish different modules. So this is one aspect which I thought is interesting. And as far as the LLM is concerned, we have 1-year model, 2-year model. And certainly, I am sure everybody agrees that the one-year LLM model isn't able to impart successfully the teaching and the writing research abilities in the researchers, the LLM students. Apart from that, even if the one-year LLM proposes to be beneficial for people who look for jobs in the corporate sector, whether that one-year LLM is able to impart those key drafting or transactional skills or the drafting petition skills and so on. And the third aspect certainly is the continuing professional legal education. So how for lawyers, how can the law schools be engaged in preparing competence-based skills? Certainly for the lawyers, lawyers also need continuing legal education. Thank you, sir, for the time. I just hope that this will be useful for our colleagues.
Thank you so much. And any other participant would want to share on this? What, according to you, are the competencies of law
graduate? Sir, in the chat box, there are a few comments. If you can just look at that.
Yes. These are all... I think these are all about the general competencies, I think.
Hello.
Yes.
Professor Shanta Kumar, thank you very much for a brilliant presentation.
Oh, yeah, you're a pleasant guest. Yeah. Surprise to have Dr. Purvi.
Thank you for a brilliant presentation. I just have one concern when we talk about the general competency, that act within the legal framework. You know, I always recall a fundamental duty that, you know, how to develop a critical inquiry and scientific temper and reforms. So if we always, you know, ask our students to look through within the legal setup and the legal framework, probably we would not be able to, you know, engage with the newer interpretation and the, you know, think through which is more innovative in terms of these. Subtle nuances on particular subject. So this is the only observation which I have. Thank you so much.
Dr. Purvi, you know, we were talking about the general graduates. So for them, you know, when we said, you know, be within the legal framework, okay, that is for them to comply with the laws, you know, whatever it is. For laws, that's all. Okay. Or, you know, In legal term, we can say rule of law, respect.
Yeah, so respect for laws would be
for law students, yes, of course. Yes.
Yeah.
They need to come out with the new interpretations. You know that.
Yes. Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you, so nice of you for joining in today's session. Thank you. So now let me share my screen. Yes. So this is what is the outcome of our 3 days of discussion, deliberation, you know, arguments, fight, agreement, disagreement. So with all these things, then we could make it. And of course, what you see on screen is, in fact, after making it as a meta profile, which means by clubbing it from various other corners, whatever has come, then we had clubbed it and then we had arranged it as knowledge. Now I think you can look at each one of these competencies. So we taught knowledge and understanding of basic legal theories, concepts and laws. So conceptual clarity needs to be very, very important. For example, that is why, you know, we lay a lot of emphasis on subjects like jurisprudence, where we teach not only legal theory, but we also teach them certain juristic concepts. Like rights, you know, when we talk about right, again, we talk about various forms of it, like when you call it as a claim, when you call it as a right, when it is all these things, you know, so whatever, you know, conceptual clarity is something very, very important, especially for a word like right. People very casually use this word, right? So we need to only make them understand, you know, what exactly they mean by that particular concept. Second is knowledge and understanding of socio-economic and political context. and ability to take them into consideration in the creation, interpretation, and application of law. Because every law is made under a specific social circumstance or a political circumstance, depending on the political party ruling at that particular point of time, their ideologies, depending on the social circumstances that was prevailing at that particular point of time. Many laws that are being made now, keeping this pandemic in mind, maybe after 10, 15 years, people will laugh at this. They will not understand, you know, why this was made. But then people will think that, you know, what is this? Why is that this was a law at that particular point of time? People will think like that without even understanding what was the need for it. For example, if I do not, many of you must have, you know, seen some videos which is circulating in WhatsApp groups about the discussion on wearing masks, a discussion which happened in some legislative assembly in one of the states in the United States. People were arguing like how it infringes their right and this and that. So these, you know, so that is something which we need to teach our students. You know, we felt that understanding a law with respect to the socio-economic and political context in which that law is made, for interpreting that law, that is very, very important. This will help the lawyers to, you know, 20 years back, if they are arguing a particular provision of a law which was made in 2020, then they should be able to tell that this law was relevant at that particular point of time because the context was that, to avoid which mischief the rule was made. But today that mischief is no more there, and therefore, so this is just an example I'm telling, but we need to emphasize, whenever we ask students to study a law, we should not ask them to study law in isolation, not only the barrette, but they need to spend more time in understanding the background in which the law is made, which will help them to understand the law in the right perspective. So this is something, I'm just giving some examples of what we need to do it in law schools. Command over legal language, the official language of the court, which is very important, using appropriate language and appropriate terms in the court, and we need to train students in it. Knowledge and understanding of various dispute resolution methods. So it's not that immediately we should ask or advise our clients to go to the court. You should see what are the other options available, whether this could be resolved by conciliation, whether this could be resolved by arbitration, students should be exposed to various forms of dispute resolution. And more than that, you know, we need to talk to them about, nowadays it's important that people need to know about dispute avoidance. I know that now not every law student graduating from a law school is taking up litigation. They're going and joining law firms where they're doing a lot of due diligence work. And the idea behind the due diligence work the transactional lawyers do is to avoid disputes in future, avoid getting into any legal problems at a later point of time. So, but then, you know, we do not train in the law school what all things that they need to do in the name of due diligence. Like, so I think only a specific set of students who take up corporate law honors will get exposed to these things, but generally other law graduates are not trained on dispute avoidance. How do we carefully incorporate things in the agreement itself to ensure that there is no ambiguity, there is no possibility of any dispute in interpretation and other things. So all those things. So dispute avoidance and dispute resolution, these things we need to do. Some of these skills, legal drafting skills. So the kind of exercise that we give, the opportunity that we give to our students in the law schools is very, very minimal. In all these 5 years, we just set apart one course on drafting, and that too with so much of, you know, syllabus in it. In fact, students do not get an active time, a considerable substantial time to enhance their drafting skills. So how do we incorporate it in every law paper? Like, for example, I have seen institutions where they teach law of contracts, not one paper, two paper, but they have not shown to students how a contract will look like or how a contract is drafted. So these are certain things, you know, which we can think of incorporating. A law of any teacher, you know, teaching law of contract, they can think of incorporating it, you know, like you can actually teach consideration by drafting a paragraph in a contract which talks about consideration in an agreement. But then we don't do that. We only look into the section of the Contract Act, then we explain it with the help of case laws, and then we just give them examples of what is consideration, what is not consideration, but then we do not actually make them write a paragraph of the contract which talks about consideration. There you should, we need to give these kind of skill sets. So this is again, you know, capacity to read objectively and interpret legal text in context. That's what, you know, legal interpreting it in the context is very, very important, which the present day lawyers are not being taught in the law school. So therefore, these are something. And capacity to dissect the facts and identify which is the actual fact in issue. But these are something which is very, very important. There will be a client will come and throw to a lawyer a number of things, but then it's the lawyer's skill to pick up what is, which fact is relevant to be taken up to the court and what orders they need to get. So that is something, you know, how do you identify, you know, these kind of opportunities do we give to our law students to learn how to dissect the facts, how to find and apply the law to the facts in issue, capacity to identify the ratio and arbiter in a judicial decision, ability to do a quality legal research, both doctrinal and empirical, right? Capacity to identify the gaps in law and innovate for legal reform, right? Ability for legal and judicial reasoning, ability to simplify and explain law to a common man, ability to plead the case effectively, ability to examine and cross-examine witnesses. Do we do all these things in the law school? Keep asking yourself all these things. When you look at all these things, see whether we are imparting this competency on our student. Are we telling them, you know, are we giving them an opportunity for them to actually acquire the skill of examining witnesses or cross-examining? They don't get this opportunity as long as they are there in the law school for 5 long years. And that is why a student who is not confident as to handle a case for 5 long years when they are with us, he just goes to the bar, you know, enrolls and then works, joins a lawyer's office, and within 6 months, he is confident. He thinks he knows more than what our teachers know in the law schools. So that kind of confidence he just acquires in 6 months of legal practice. So what he could not learn, those things, you know, we need to start focusing and working on it to make our law schools very effective. And then that will bring in a lot of respect for law teachers in this country, if we are able to do that. Otherwise, I can see, you know, the student, interestingly, I'm now coming across number of young law students coming out with a lot of startups where they are talking about, they are trying to come out with some blog or some platform where they want to write something. And then they specifically say to bridge the gap between theory and practice in the law schools, it's not done this. So these students start writing about it even before they graduate. So that is because we have given them the opportunity in ensuring that we are not providing all these skill sets. So ability to foresee the consequences while enacting and interpreting a law, ability to harmonize. And now coming to the attitudes. This is something which is very, very important. You all will know about the importance of attitudes for success in any profession. So court craft and etiquettes, right? Ability to practice law without compromising ethics. Ability to do pro bono advocacy and take up social legal outreach programs. Ability to work as a legal expert in a transdisciplinary team. Capacity to act honestly, diligently, and transparently in all professional endeavors. Commitment to justice and fairness in all situations. So this is all is about the competencies that what we drafted as a small team as part of the Tuning India project. Now I'll this is all that I have. The idea of sharing it is I started this session by telling that I'm no expert in this particular topic because I have also learned it very recently. Since I was fortunate that I was involved in this project, so I know a little bit. Otherwise, I'm not an expert in this competency-based education. But it made me think, it made me realize that, okay, I now have a checklist of what my student passing out from my institution need to possess, knowledge, skill, attitude. Now, at least, you know, while looking at a curriculum, now I can do a mapping of my curriculum with this competencies and see that this subject, what it gives, whether I need to keep this subject or not. If I have a subject which does not do anything, then what is that I'm doing? If I can introduce certain subjects which can give them these competencies, for example, time management, stress management, all these things we talked about, we do not, our law school curriculum actually per se doesn't have. So we need to bring in certain courses which can even, you know, talk about all these things, which will help them to acquire all these skills. So this is the idea behind this session. So the idea is to prepare a checklist. In fact, I forgot to mention one thing at the beginning, that before we started doing this project, I was just trying to find out, to see that, was there any other effort made anywhere in the world on this thing. Interestingly, I could see that in the University of California, the Berkeley Law School have done a similar exercise, and which is available in the internet. You can all see that. I think I also have it on my screen. Let me share that. It's called the Berkeley. Let me see. Yes, I have it here. Yes. So this is this document. This is a PDF document which has what they call it as 26 lawyering effectiveness factors, which is also known as the Berkeley factors because the Berkeley Law School came out with it. So according to them, for lawyering effectiveness, a law graduate must possess all these skills. So if you can see, you know, analysis and reasoning. So a student should be able to use analytical skills, logic and reasoning to approach problems. So there is an expansion. You can read from here. Creativity and innovation. He must be able to think outside the box, develop innovative approach and solution. Problem solving, effectively identifying problem and deriving appropriate solution. Practical judgment determines effective and realistic approach to problem. Providing advice and counsel and building relationship with clients. Fact finding, researching the law, speaking, writing, listening, influencing and advocating, questioning and interviewing, negotiation skills, strategic planning, organizing and managing one's own work, organizing and managing others' work, the teamwork, evaluation, development and mentoring, developing relationship within the legal profession, what we call it as networking, you know, what opportunities that we provide, networking and business development, community involvement and service, integrity and honesty, stress management, passion and engagement, diligence, self-development, able to see the world through the eyes of others, what we call it as the empathy, right? So how do we, this is an effort made by the Berkeley Law School under University of California, which is known as the Berkeley Law School. Apart from this, I have not come across any such work being done in this particular field. So this is all I wanted to say. Thank you so much for this opportunity. Maybe we still have 10 more minutes wherein if there are certain questions we can answer. We can discuss for 10 minutes and then we can proceed. So over to Vishnu or Hari Shankar.
Hari.
Yeah, I was just looking at the chat box and interestingly, so many of us have contributed to the
list of competencies.
Yeah.
Yes, I'm very happy that, you know, I think we need a workshop to prepare this list of competencies, which can act as a checklist for the Indian law schools.
Right, sir. Right, right. Yeah.
Yeah. So, can we give opportunity to our participants to raise questions by themselves?
Yes. Yeah, that's what I was thinking. So we can't see any questions as of now. So if there are any questions to Professor Shantakumar,
not only questions, you know, maybe if they want to add to this discussion, if they have something to say on this, like Purvi Madam came out and said that that you know we need to encourage scientific temper and you know
I think Professor Povi is back.
I just would like to add one thing. Professor Shantakumar, it was very nice. We at the university also has been deliberating a lot, and we have implemented outcome-based education model since 2013. And there is a constant research and reflections going on. What I, at the end of the, I think, 5 years of our OBE practice, what we have realized that most important thing is the pedagogical approaches by the faculty members. So realization of this fact is one thing. But you know, even if you talk about a simple thing, that attitudinal change among the students or to making them more resilient, how are we going to go about it? You know, these are the different generation of learners. So you know, their aspirations, their approach of dealing with certain things is entirely different than most of the teachers, right? So at this point in time, I think along with this, if we also focus and give little more emphasis on the pedagogical approaches to deal with, to build this kind of a competences, may it be in the case of knowledge, skills, and values. So I mean, thanks to Vishnu you for making this brilliant show. I think the next session in the series should be on the pedagogical tools, techniques, and approaches.
Thank you, Dr. Purvi. In fact, that is the next step to follow, because once you know that these are the competencies, then we teachers need to sit and find out how do we impart these competencies. Now, during my teaching of Indian Penal Code, what are the competencies associated with Indian Penal Code, or what are the competencies that are expected? I can include it in teaching that subject, so that you are very right that it should become a part of our teaching methodology, and the teachers need to be told about these competencies, and they should also be told that while teaching X particular subject, that's what if you will allow me, I did not share that part of the screen where that presentation, what I was sharing, it had the second part which I did not share, is that was on teaching environmental law, competencies required for teaching environmental law, which we did a workshop. And for example, this was on teaching environmental. So now this was completely on pedagogy. Now we asked the teachers, identify what are the competencies in the list which you think that the course on environmental should ideally aim at developing. Map these competencies with these things. And are there any other competencies? So what revision, what method of evaluation to assess this competence? How to set your question paper to assess whether students, after undergoing your course on environmental law, would have done it. So likewise, we are developing it subject-wise. And I think that's rightly pointed out by Dr. Purvi, that is the most important step next we should focus on.
Thank you, Professor. Even I had a similar thought, actually. I mean, while we were discussing about the competencies or attributes, and later on the pedagogical competencies. But interestingly, in India, and I think even in most of the law schools, we don't, especially in India, fresh LLM graduates, even I started as a fresh LLM graduate to start teaching in a national law university. So, after your law school or your postgraduate studies, you don't get to, you're not trained as a teacher. So maybe you're a good researcher, you can write well, you can speak well, but there are, I'm not sure, can we think of a system where we can teach or train law teachers and even other teachers? Earlier, we used to have what is known as the Bachelor of Education, not for law specifically. Not sure whether they're still running it, but that problem is still there. Just a thought.
That I always share in every program that I speak. I make it a point to emphasize that, legal education is taken for granted. You just have to have an LLM and then pass this UGC NET examination, just take the multiple choice question. And then I don't know how UGC thinks that you become a great teacher after doing it. This is like I used to draw this analogy, giving an Airbus flight to an MTech graduate who had cleared UGC NET examination, asking him to fly with 180 passengers.
That's a great analogy.
That's what is actually happening. In fact, we need to have a formal institution to train our postgraduates, you know, even after completing their LLM. I think that's where your forum can create. You can play a major role, because you already have like-minded people together under one fold. Maybe I think you know, you can seek the help of support of institutions like us and our.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, and we'll be able to.
Very happy to host. In fact, Dr. Purvi is very proactive, especially when it comes to legal education, clinical legal education, justice education. She's doing a lot of work in this particular domain. I think that is why she is here today to find out what is being discussed about all this. So you should start approaching these institutions for any support. We will always be happy to do that. I'm sure even Purvi will immediately agree for such proposals.
Definitely, it would be a pleasure. Thank you.
Yes, sir. We'll definitely do that. We'll approach you with the proposal, Purvi ma'am, and you and the other senior teachers and the vice chancellors. Of course, we'll be happy to do that.
Yes, I think, sir. If there are no more questions, I can ask colleague Dr. Rishangak to propose a formal word of thanks or concluding remarks.
Hari, one second. There are few senior teachers. I think I saw Professor Avasthi, sir, Anju Valley, Tikku ma'am, if they have something. And I saw few more. Anil from NUALS.
Sir, so do I have the, can I ask a question?
Yeah, please.
All right, so this is basically a question come observation.
Can you introduce yourself, madam?
Yes, sir. My name is Mini Srivastav. I'm assistant professor at Amity Law School, Noida, teaching here for the past 5 years. Oh. And basically my question come observation is regarding, so every year we see that in the month of May, June, how the cutoffs of the colleges are increasing every year, I believe 99%, you know. So the and we also find that there are so many students actually getting so many above 90% marks. So there is certain what I would say feeling of high competitiveness, which is good, but at the same time somehow I feel that these students really know how to win, but somehow they lack the ability to setback. It's so life is not always about winning. You also get setback. So how to deal with that effect? So stress management, as Shantar.
Yes, that is precisely what we were talking about. You know, that is the object of this program. You know, to talk about equipping students to face real life situations. It's not only, you know, teaching them certain theories and concepts of law, but we need to give them certain other things which will make them a complete human being. So how do we do it as part of our curriculum? Whether our curriculum takes care of all these things, time management, stress management, thinking critically, working as a team.
Very important skills.
Yes. We agree with that, madam. Yes.
Yes.
And yeah, that is why that is the gap that we are finding in the present legal education system. So I think we need to work on this. I think we need to meet very often, you know, do some long duration workshop to take all inputs from people like you, and then we should go ahead.
Sir, I have one question, sir.
Yes, sir.
Vishnu, sir?
Yes.
Yes, sir. Yeah, please. Sir, this is Rashmi from Bangalore, Daily Society's Law College. Sir, as in most of the colleges, earlier it used to be LLB honors or just LLB. Now we have BBA LLB, BA LLB and BCom LLB. So we have LLBs in more specific, but the curriculum, you know, majority of the curriculum remains the same. So I think there has to be something done to differentiate the basic pedagogies of all these specific branches. So how do we teaching jurisprudence for BCom, jurisprudence for BBA, BA, I think there has to be some different pedagogy adopted for different streams. That's what I feel, and I want to hear from you also, sir.
Yeah, in fact, this is what Professor N.L. Mitra used to always say and complain rather. He says that, you know, the idea of an integrated law program is no more integrated law program. It has now become a dual degree program. So it's no more an integrated program because we lack that skill to integrate it. We must admit, the law teachers need to admit, the humanities teachers, the social science teachers, the science teachers, the commerce teachers, we all have not been told how to integrate the teaching of law with respect to the discipline what you are teaching. So this is something which is a serious gap, madam. In fact, I would want to remember and recognize Professor N.L. Mitra, because he is one person who uses all platforms where he complains this, that this integration is not happening. It's not an integrated five-year program. It's a dual degree program. Or just teaching it as two separate degrees. It's you are right. You are very right, madam. We agree with you.
Thank you, sir.
Namaskar. Namaskar.
Yes, ma'am, please.
Thank you very much, Professor Shanta Kumar. I am Anju Bali Tekku from Faculty of Law, University of Delhi.
Welcome, madam. Welcome. Thank you so much for joining us today.
I had been with National Law University Delhi also for 3 years in the initial founding stages. Now, my observations are only two prompt. One is with reference to the pedagogical input. I believe somewhere the Bar Council of India needs to withdraw. And as far as legal education is concerned, Bar Council should be related with the role of lawyers and maybe their eligibility conditions and disciplinary conditions, etc., etc. As far as legal education is concerned, and if we are talking about competencies, somewhere the teachers, until and unless, are given the opportunity to expose themselves with the practical difficulties of everyday life. And until and unless they have an exposure in the courtrooms, or for that matter, different tribunals and different dispute resolution mechanisms, I wonder how can a person have an idea, even an iota of an idea, as to what are the kind of difficulties which can possibly crop up. And accordingly, there can then be a possibility and potentiality of framing the course that one is going to take up or deliver in the specific institution. So that is from one standpoint, that when we're talking about legal education and what are the kind of knowledge, skill, attributes that a person should have once a person comes out of the law college. So visualizing all that would be possible only and only when we are allowing the teachers to have that exposure. That takes me to the training of teachers, about which Harishankar said that we are not trained. After LLM also, we do not have any kind of training. I'm afraid when we did our LLM way back in mid-80s, we happen to have 2 years, and even now we happen to have indeed 2 years program and 3 years program. The very idea of having 2 years and 3 years program was to not only give the information about the nitty-gritties and jurisprudential aspects of a given course subject, but it was also how do we present ourselves. So there used to be presentations in each and every paper, and those presentations were being heard by senior professors, not one, at least three or four of them, giving you their input that what all you need to improve upon and what all you need to include and exclude. So that's where there was the training happening on the part of the institutions supporting the future teachers. So LLM was not only to give them research input. I'm afraid 1 year loss LLM program, I don't think that they are doing justice even with reference to research capabilities. I'm sorry, if you look into the quality of the research that is produced through dissertations, it is terrible. It's just, and today in today's technological world, it is copy, cut, paste. And they are really very smart as far as the plagiarism test and all that is concerned.
So, yeah, they have learned the art of cheating, turn it in.
So when we are talking about pedagogical tools, somewhere the institution and the system also needs to bring about a change in it to itself. Only then we can expect all these knowledge, skills, and attributes to be developed and shared across with the students. That's all from my side as an observation. Thank you very much for giving me that space.
We agree with you, madam. Completely. Nobody can defend. Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon.
You're not audible, Dr. Ayush. Can you be a bit louder?
Yeah, now is it audible?
Yes, please.
Okay, so my name is Ayush Pandey. I'm a pass out from Terry University. I'm a student of Vishnu sir, and I've taught in Jagran Lake City University, Bhopal for 6 months. And now preparing for judiciary. So I had just this one question, which was referred to us by Dr. Ghayur Alam sir, who teaches in NLIU Bhopal, when we were having the refresher course in our school. So what he said was that we brainstorm a lot upon how should be the pedagogy, how should we move forward and talk about teaching and how, what competencies should be developed, like we talked about in this webinar, but they never actually materialized because we can't communicate it to the government or the people who are actually making policies on behalf. So is it even possible to make on the lines of Bar Council of India some association of teachers, where teachers can put forth their claims, their suggestions and recommendations to the government? So is there any work that should be done on that behalf? I just wanted to know thoughts of Shanta sir on this line of approach. Like on the lines of Bar Council of India, can teachers also make some of their own association that raises their own concerns and voices?
No, Ayush, we have a number of associations and a number of forum where we keep talking about it. But then ultimately, I think that there is a missing link between the teachers and the Bar Council, right? So there is no such connect there. That last mile connectivity is currently missing. So we are there talking. We have a lot of ideas to transform, reform legal education. But then, you know, it's not effectively communicated to the Bar Council ultimately, who can put your ideas into practice. That last mile connectivity is missing. Maybe, you know, I think there is no such consistent effort taken. Any time is the right time for us to act on it. I think we should start doing this. But we always end up a program with this suggestion and then after that we don't do it. This is a very sad part of it. I agree with you that last mile connectivity is missing currently. Who can, you know, take it up to the Bar Council, follow it up with them and then see that all these ideas are debated within the Bar Council and adequate representation for law teachers Council is there, where we can raise our voice and we can give our input.
Ghayur Alam sir was asked this similar question in that report session. So he said in a very casual tone that it is you that should do this. And then we all laughed about it. But yeah, so
right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Risham, can you please turn on your screen and can you hear me?
Okay. So I take this opportunity to thank Professor Shanta Kumar for his wonderful, erudite and, you know, engaging talk on this topical issue of competencies-based legal education. And I must say that, you know, sir, this is, you know, I mean, we expect these type of innovative and engaging workshop format models of deliberation. And you have, you know, forced nearly everybody to engage with you. So for the benefit of some of our participants who joined in late, I'll just give a brief overview. So, I mean, Professor Shanta Kumar started off with explaining the historical basis of the competencies-based education, which initially started in the US because they were concerned about the category and the competence of engineers. So there was a Washington Accord, which was followed by similar accords in Europe. And these were basically to check the quality of the people, of the experts who are going to join those countries. So we are in a global economy. There is a free movement of people, and hence there is a need to check the competencies. And then Professor Shantakumar explained his involvement in this project of EU, the Turning India project. And we always, the academics cherish and we enjoy these discussions when an academic speaks of from his own research work. So we were fortunate, and we really enjoyed your research, your presentations. This has forced us to also think that today a pandemic has forced law schools, and they need to consider how competency-based education models can be employed to advance educational objectives for students seeking to enter the market for legal services. In this new environment, law schools need to reimagine themselves as educators for students interested in learning about the legal services sector, and not simply those seeking. So maybe I could summarize, or also we were also benefited by some observations of our other senior colleagues. There are some aspects I had also pointed out, that one aspect is, which we can take as, time is not the measure of accomplishment today. And maybe we can also focus upon the modules. So we have semester system. However, we have seen the difficulty in pursuing education in a timely manner. So I'm sure that the competencies-based education can also be identified through modules. So we have the MOOC modules, and I'm sure most of us have been involved in creating those modules. Secondly, there has to be a centrality of competencies, learning outcomes and assessments. To identify the competencies, students must master to achieve the desired learning outcomes and then work through each of them. And the teachers need to be with them throughout. And then third, modularization of course material. And online technologies make it possible to modularize the learning process, that is to break semester-long courses into shorter learning units or modules, which can be studied in sequence or separately. So we have also been benefited by considered views of our senior colleagues, Professor Purvi, Professor Anju Tikku, colleagues Harishankar, Vishnu, Minish Srivastava, and others. We also take note of the valuable suggestion to try to take forward the concept of a workshop on teaching pedagogy involving competencies, experiential skills on our Legal Academia Forum. The possibilities abound. On behalf of the Legal Academia Forum, I thank one and all for joining us. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.